Good morning, everyone. I think speaker is more energetic than the participants. Good morning, everyone.
That's
right. Okay, so just before I'm starting this presentation, so my one question to you. What do you expect from this lab design, accommodation and environment? Like, what are your expectations? Like, what you're expecting that I will be presenting to you? Or what will be your, like, intake or what you want me to present here? Definitely. What else?
Design of
yeah. How the laboratory to be designed to be take like we should take care of the safety and all other aspects, right? So you are very much right in your expectations. So I will be presenting to you the laboratory design, accommodation and environment. And as you have rightly said, so first of all, when we are designing a laboratory, so what factors to be considered in that? So this is the table of contents which I will be presenting to you. So when we are first starting, so what are the key factors which should be taken into consideration? And above all, safety is the top priority, right, for everyone. Okay, so when we are designing a laboratory, so first we should take into account the safety factors which are going to impact to the users. Users means the lab analysts and the laboratory staff. And then the most important thing is the zoning, laboratory zoning, and then the workflow, then how the partitions and finishes should be in the laboratory, the other utility services like air handling units, lighting, pipes, and then obviously we are working with the equipments. So to start with, when we are designing a laboratory, the key design drivers are the technology and equipment, which type of technology, HPLC, UPLC, gases, or in the microbiology laboratory are the other things like if we are using any ELISA technique. So all these factors we need to take care before designing the laboratory. As I mentioned, safety and health, it should be a safer workplace for all of us, because when we are working in a microbiology laboratory, we will be exposed to hazardous microorganisms. And when we are working in a chemical laboratory, we will be exposed to vapors of acids or solvents. So that is why I told that safety and health is the most important thing, because we are the people who are working in the laboratory for at least 8 to 10 hours in the laboratory. So health should be more important. Then the space should be open and flexible. We have to work as a team. And when we are working in the laboratory and when we are designing the laboratory, so we should also take care of the environmental factors. So can anybody tell me which environmental factors come into play when we are in the laboratory?
Temperature.
Definitely. Temperature and humidity. Because we will be more uncomfortable if the temperature is too high or if the humidity is too high in the laboratory. And environment, it also takes care that whatever we will be disposing into the our outer environment. For example, microbiological waste or solvent waste or whatever water we use when we do the washing of the glassware and all these residues, they are removed from the glassware. So the laboratory must be designed taking into consideration the safety. First of all, there should be the unauthorized entrance into the laboratory. So in that case, we will be discussing accessibility and zoning. The other important thing is the workflow, a good workflow, so that our time is not wasted. Then overcrowding and too much, if there are too much equipments in the laboratory, so that so then how to take care of all these circulation designs. When we are working with high volumes or when we are working with very hazardous microorganisms, so we will be discussing the containment in the laboratory. And there is a risk of infestation, rodents and insects. So we will also be discussing how our internal partitions should be. And when we are working in the laboratories, then especially in the microbiology laboratory, then there is a risk of generation of the aerosols in the laboratory. So we will be discussing about the air handling units. So coming to zoning and flow analysis. So most of us, when we are working in a laboratory, there are microbiology laboratory, there is a physical and chemical analysis laboratory, and in certain areas there are some sensory laboratories are also there. If we are in a production unit, in a food manufacturing facility, they are also having both microbiology, physical chemical analysis laboratory, and as well as the sensory laboratory also. So first of all, there should be a separate zone depending on type of analysis and rooms. When there is a both microbiology and physical analysis or chemical analysis going on in the laboratory, so microbiology laboratory must be segregated physically from a chemistry laboratory. And the other administrative tasks we are also doing in the there, so they should also be segregated. And the most important factor is, whenever there is a microbiology laboratory in a production unit, so there must never be a direct access to the production area. Otherwise, what will happen? Definitely, we will be from the microbiology laboratory because it is the most contaminated area. Here we are working with billions of microorganisms. If there is a direct access from the microbiology laboratory to the production area, then we will be contaminating the production area. So this is the most important thing while designing a laboratory. Then coming to the flow analysis. So the most important thing is, when we receive the samples, definitely there is some registration of the samples, acknowledgement of samples, and the samples are processing, then these are being distributed to microbiology laboratory separately, chemical laboratory separately. So definitely this particular area where we are receiving the sample, it must be near to the entrance of the laboratory. Can anybody tell me why it should be near the entrance of the laboratory? Yes, because we are trained how to work in a laboratory, but we don't want to put any outside person whose role is to just submit the sample, so we can't put that person on risk in our laboratory. So that is why it should be at the entrance of the laboratory. And when there is a side by side, when there is a microbiology laboratory also there, then there should be proper signals on the signals must be displayed outside of the laboratory. For example, if it's a microbiology laboratory, then the biological hazard sign must be there, because here we are working with group 2, group 3 microorganisms, and the authorized access sign must also be displayed in front of the laboratory. When we are talking about the access control, either can be a signal, or there can be, you must have heard about the biometric systems, the finger punching, access control, these type of systems, they are available nowadays. So this is the flow, everybody agrees to it? So this is the flow in a laboratory. We receive the samples, and here either samples are accepted or rejected if they are not complying to the requirement, as you were mentioning during your discussion in the previous presentation. If the samples are not intact, or if they are not in the original container, for example microbiology, we don't accept the samples, right? So acceptance and rejection, it is handling here. Then there is a sample processing and distribution. Sample preparation, the first step is the preparation. We prepare the samples for the further process, for example injecting into a HPLC or UPLC. And from here the samples are distributed to different type of labs, physical laboratory separately and microbiology laboratory separately. And then the analysis happens, data is generated, data interpretation is there, and then finally the data is released. So this is the workflow in the laboratory. So when we are designing a laboratory, so first we should target, there should be a lean concept. Lean means we should not waste our time too much in the different activities. So it should be a smoother, it's a lean workflow. Lean means we should minimize the handling distances. So there should not be any crisscross of the activities. If I take one example, see, look at this process. So there is one sample which is waiting for analysis. So in one bench we can start like that. Suppose this is the entrance of the laboratory. Here there can be a rack or a table where the samples which are waiting for analysis. So here we can keep these samples, and then the next step could be the sample preparation. Then the other thing will be here, sample processing, or some equipments are lying there. And then outward, then discarding of the samples, or when we are finishing of the analysis. So the visibility should be, we should improve the visibility also. If it is a U-shaped cell, then there the visibility is improved. Whether there is a one person, whether there are two person, or whether there are three persons. So all the equipments or the other analytical areas from here, if the person is standing, it's quite visible to everyone. If we in between we put the partitions, then the person will not be able to see what is happening on the other side of the bench. And even there, then there will also be the crisscross of activities also. So when we are designing a microbiology laboratory, the first important thing we have to, it should be designed in a way to prevent the release of microorganisms into the environment and provide protection to the laboratory people, the analysts who are working in the laboratory. So hence, it's the same thing which I told you, that the entrance to this laboratory must be restricted, and it should be separated from the areas that are open to unrestricted traffic flow within the building. So we should not unnecessarily put the people on risk who are maybe moving nearby. So this is one zoning example into the microbiology laboratory. There is a admission lock. Everybody knows in microbiology laboratory there is a shoe change area. So there is a admission lock, and when we enter into the laboratory, see, media preparation room is different, and from the media preparation room the media goes into the media pre-warming or sample vein, and these are the other analytical area where the samples are processed. After sample processing, the sample goes into the incubation room, and after incubation room again it comes to the table where we count the colonies, and then after that the sample goes, whatever we have to be decontaminated, sample goes into, from this side it goes into the decontamination room where it is autoclaved, and after that washing, and then the decontaminated waste material, it comes out of the laboratory. There is no way out back principle, that the waste, it should not again go from the same area from where the sample has entered. Otherwise there is a high risk of the cross contamination. And in the laboratory, in microbiology laboratory, we should have separate zones for activities that may result in the cross contamination, as I mentioned in my previous slide. So this is an example of a shoe change area. So there should be an admission lock, and there should be a space for keeping the shoes. When we change the shoes before entering into the laboratory, there should be a space for keeping our aprons when we change the aprons, right? In certain areas there are two type of aprons. One, the aprons which are being, you can use outside, and the certain aprons which are used in the laboratory inside. And there must be a hand wash facility available. There should be a disinfectant, soap, and it should be the paper towel should also be there. Here the one important thing which is coming is that generally we have seen there are the hand dryers. There should not be the hand dryers in the, at least in the microbiology laboratory, because they are the biggest source of spreading the contamination. So there must always be the paper towels available, which we call it as the tissue papers. In the laboratory, we should have certain open spaces, if possible, so that we can, there should be a break room, some spaces which can promote the informal interaction between the persons and the some activities related to the other small activities which we can perform in the laboratory. And when we are designing a laboratory, this is very much obvious from this picture. see, this is a workbench, this is a workbench, and these are all the workbenches. Okay, so there should be a minimum space of 0.9 to 1 meter for a single person to move properly. When there is a space in between these two benches, so as depicted in the picture, so one person should be able to stand properly and doing his activities. The other person can also do all his analytical activities in a comfortable manner. Because as I mentioned, when we are designing a laboratory, so we have to take care of the safety of the people also. Otherwise, it will lead to the accidents. And sometimes in the laboratories, there is a bench this way, person is sitting or working, a bench this way, another person has to move in between. So that is why minimum 1.45 meter space must be there. As I am relating it to the safety. When we are working in the laboratory, we are dealing with many hazardous tasks. There could be a fire also in the lab. There could be a splashing of any acid or solvent, and in that case, person has to really rush out of the laboratory in case of any fire also. So in that case, the minimum distance should be, after every 20 meters, there should be one exit in the laboratory, minimum after 20 meters. So this, how to calculate this 20 meters? So it is the total distance to be covered by a person. It should not be like that door is in this single straight line, it's a 20 meter from a distance. Understand? Minimum distance which a person has to cover while coming out of the laboratory or coming out of the, in case of the emergency. So the number of emergency exits in the laboratory, it depends upon various factors, what is the local legislation and how many people they working in a room and what are the running distances, size of the building or a room. Sometimes the building is very, they are the lengthy, they are very big in length. So then in that case, after every 20 meters, some door should be there. And also the arrangement of the workplace. So these are the very, very important factors which should be taken care of while designing a laboratory. Now we're talking about the emergency doors and passages. So the minimum dimension of emergency doors, I'm talking about the door only from where the person has to exit. Okay, if it is a single leaf, you can understand the single leaf, it's just one door. It should be minimum 0.9. It's the same way as I mentioned earlier, a passage for a single person to move, it should be 0.9, which I mentioned earlier. So similarly, the door should be minimum 0.9 meter. And if it is a double leaf, door is a double leaf, but still it is opening from one side only, then again it should be at least 0.19 meter. And if it is a double leaf, two doors we open, 0.5 one side, 0.5 another side, so total it becomes the 1 meter. And the clearance of doors must be at least 2 meter to avoid bumping the head on the way. Clearance means the overall height of the door, so it should be minimum 2 meters, otherwise some people they are very tall, 6'4", 6'5", this is the height which we can say maximum also, some people even 7 feet also. So there should be minimum 2 meter high. And again, further depends, if there are too many people working in the laboratory, then we should take into consideration the other dimension also, if occupancy level is more than 100 in the laboratory. And at the same time, suppose there is a possibility some visitor can also be there in your laboratory. You are working in the lab for such a long time, so you know everything, the escape routes and everything. But sometimes what happens, a visitor is accompanying you or a new joinee has come into your lab who is not familiar with your laboratory. So that is why it becomes more important that these signals must be there. It must be displayed. So suppose I am coming out of this building, I have to obviously open this door. Then in front of the door, when I go to this corridor, this type of sign must be there. If in case of emergency, where I have to rush, I'm not familiar of this building. So I must know in case of emergency, where I have to rush and which is the shortest route which will take me out of this building. So hence all these signs must be there. So all these doors, windows, they should be connected to the escape routes, and these doors, emergency door, they must be, not the emergency door, the other doors, they must be fire resistant. So they should be able to withstand the fire for at least 30 minutes. If they will not be fire resistant, then the purpose of this emergency exit or the door, it gets diluted, because this in the first instance the door will be on fire because it's made up of the flammable material. So from where we will rush out. Now coming to internal partitions and finishes, again coming to the door that I was talking about, the emergency exit door. Now I'm talking about the normal doors. So this is in a laboratory, this door is inside a laboratory, we are working. So we should not be very much scared of the thieves or anybody entering into the laboratory. That is why it's specially mentioned that these access to laboratory should be built without door threshold for safety reasons. Due to any reason, there is a sudden instance of fire or sudden splashing of acid, person has to run, or the door is locked or something like that. So it should be able to withstand. So whatever threshold I will be applying to open this door, so it should be easily breakable so that the person can come out easily from here. And even if you have a trolley with you, maybe you can just ram that trolley into the door so that the way is, there is a way for the people to escape. And at the same time, there should be, for each door which is in the laboratory, there should be a see-through window should be there, so that in some cases we see the people, they are working alone in the laboratory, and the person, it may happen the person is not medically fit and person gets fainted, so that the anybody else who is around or who is working in a side by rooms, and the person can peep through and the person can immediately go to help that person. There should be windows in the laboratory, and wherever possible, these windows must be opening into the corridor for the same reason what I mentioned earlier, for the safety reason. There should be see-through windows, and they must be opening into the corridor and even to the outside. And at the same time, these windows should be of a laminated safety glass. You understand the laminated safety glass? It's like the window of our car also. Like whenever there is a breakage, so it just shatters. So there are no sharp ends, so which can harm any person. Sometimes a situation may arise that person has to escape through the window only. Okay, in that case, that glass, it should not harm the person if any broken pieces of glass are there. Generally, in the microbiology laboratory, these windows should be sealed properly to prevent any cross contamination. But if it is a chemistry laboratory, window can be opened or it could be sealed, so both are allowed. So whenever there are these windows which can be openable, then there must be some mesh here so that these insect and flies we can reduce, or we can prevent the entry of these insects and flies. And at the same time, these windows must also be a laminated one. So 3M, it's easily available. These type of glass is easily available. And even the safety coating is also available with the 3M. Now coming to the ceiling. We have seen in the laboratories, there are false ceilings also available. But the best practices is, there should not be a ceiling, false ceiling in the laboratory. Why? The advantages are, first of all, it's very much flexible. You can take out, you can put the service line, you can bring the service lines from the ceiling also. It's very easy to plug and play. We can do the quick fittings on pipe work services because the connections are accessible from all sides. There is also cost advantage of no false ceiling. There should not be any void Otherwise, what will happen? There will be small spaces and dust starts accumulating. Then if it's a microbiology laboratory, then there is a risk of cross-contamination. And access for cleaning of exposed service, the services lines. If the service lines are coming from the ceiling and we have put a false ceiling, then again it's very difficult to access also and clean also. And then if we have installed the smoke detectors, then off and on they will be detecting these dust, and there will be again and again false alarm from these smoke detectors. So even when we are putting in the laboratory, the ceiling should be minimum 2.7 meter plus including the space required to put any service line. For a door, we are talking about 2 meter, but for ceiling, it should be 2.7 meter minimum plus the space required for putting the additional services. And if we cannot avoid false ceiling in the laboratory, then this ceiling must be of smooth metallic panel type. It should be a smooth, so that it should be easy to clean. And the opening for inspection and cleaning purposes should be provided. So we should be easily, we can, if you can look at this picture or this picture, so we can easily take out some portion of that ceiling and we can do all these cleaning of our service line, not cleaning or repair of our service lines. And the other important thing is it should be either smooth metallic panel type or it should be a plaster board which is filled and painted to provide a seamless and monolithic seal, right? As I have already mentioned, that void above the ceiling should be accessible and controllable. Now coming to flooring. The floor, it must be watertight, it should be easy to clean, and it should be resistant to chemicals. So it should not like that if some solvent, spillage of solvent is there, because it can happen in the laboratory. So that is why when we are working in a laboratory where there is we are handling the acids, more of the acids, in that case the PVC flooring is recommended. Otherwise what will happen, there will be lot of patches on the floor with these chemicals, and these should be resistant to disinfectants, because in microbiology laboratory we have to disinfect the floors almost on the daily basis, our floor also and our workbenches also, because in microbiology we are using a hypochlorite solution, and it's like very tough sort of disinfectant and which corrodes the surfaces. The floor must be electrostatic conductive, and as I have already mentioned, the PVC or rubber flooring covering is recommended in general, and where there is a more chances of getting the wetting of the floor, then it should be epoxy flooring, anti-slip epoxy flooring, so that again I'm again coming to the safety of the people. If the everything is all right, but if it's a floor is wet, then again the person can skid and he can be hurting. And in lab also you can see, this is example of the cooving application, where we just coof the corners of the laboratory so that it should be easily cleanable. The other utility services which we are using in the laboratory are the air handling, lighting, pipes. Now I'll be discussing these one. So the most comfortable temperature here, it is 23 plus minus 3. Okay, so it is not impacting our result also. Above that, this temperature, it starts impacting the results. You could have seen that our glassware, it is mentioned calibrated at 27 degrees. Okay, after that, if the temperature is above that, then it will start impacting the calibration of our glassware also. So the most recommendable temperature in tropical countries between 22 to 26 degree, and the comfortable condition of relative humidity is 50 to 60%, 50 to 60 or 40 to 70, like it's both ways, 40 to 70 is also acceptable. And the air velocity, it should not exceed 0.2 meter per second. And the input air system, it should be, the dust should be filtered with the G4 pre-filters. Many of you must be aware of all these AFU system in the laboratories and in the other areas also, because if we put the G4 filters there, then we have only need to replace the G4 filters only. If we don't put G4 filters and we directly put any HEPA filter, then there will be problem of the choking. And moreover, these G4 filters, they can be easily can be washed easily, and the dust can be removed from these filters. FET type filter should be there for air intake. And if you are in a microbiology laboratory, it is always a best practice to install a HEPA filter before the inlet and the outlet of the filter. Just one question to you, why for the outlet also in microbiology laboratory, HEPA filter? Any ideas? Yes, because in microbiology we are also removing the air from microbiology laboratory, the air is going outside. So at the same time, our responsibility is that we should not contaminate the outside environment also. That is why the outlet of microbiology laboratory HEPA filter is recommended. And at the same time, this extracted air from the laboratory, it should not vent near the factory doors, windows, intake, or into the other production areas. It's the same way that it should not, why? It should not contaminate the other areas, and at the same time, intake and outlet, it should not be at the same place. Otherwise, whatever air will be coming in, same air will be going out. Okay, in one side, if there is an inlet, then on the opposite side, there should be the outlet of the air. And the ducts which are being there in the laboratory to carry this air. So these should be, these days, these textile ducts are being used, because it's easy to wash and clean these ducts. So we can easily take out, we can wash it, and then we can again put these ducts there. So it helps in maintaining the hygiene in the laboratory, because the dust accumulation, it can happen on the ducts also. And these fans, they are preferably positioned at the outlet of the exhaust duct to maintain the negative air pressure in case of leaks. So whenever there is an outlet, there we can install additional fan, because it will suck that air. It works like same, we put the exhaust fans. And these laboratory ventilation or air conditioning ductwork should not be connected to the factory system or other non-microbiological areas. For example, if I take example of this particular building, there is a definitely there must be a microbiology laboratory here. So in that case, and the other some other administrative areas must also be there. So we should not have the same system which is catering to both microbiology laboratory as well as those administrative areas, because otherwise again there is a risk of cross contamination can happen. These are certain examples of different areas. The moisture room, it requires relative humidity 40 to 60. It's the same which I told you, temperature. And if I talk about the junior room, here there should be special explosion proof ventilation that does not allow air to stay in the room. There must be 100% supply of the fresh air, and there 5 air changes must be there per hour. After every after every 20 minutes there should be minimum after every 12 minutes there should be a air change. Fresh air comes and that stale air, it should go out. It's the same thing. The laboratory should renew air 5 to 10 times per hour. Then we have at the same time, one is our laboratory, and then we have our chemical storage rooms also. We have our reagent stores, we have our chemical stores. In that case, the air must never be recirculated. Otherwise, what will happen? The same vapors, they will be circulating there, and it will pose risk. And the air from these areas, these storage areas, it should not vent the outlet, it should not be into the corridor. It should be directly out. And the room pressure must always be negative. Why it should be negative? So that, anybody? Yes, definitely, yeah. And in microbiology, there should not be positive pressure. If the positive pressure is there, what will happen? All the microorganisms, when we will open the door, there is a risk that microorganisms can go outside immediately and then it can contaminate our area. And there should not be air recirculation in the microbiology laboratory. And if air has to be recirculated for energy saving purposes, then inlet of air and outlet, both. There should be HEPA filter must be installed. And these sterilization room where we have, these are autoclave, these are present in our media preparation room and as well as in our decontamination room. Always there must be a extraction hood available on the autoclave so that whatever this steam or air is coming out from the autoclave, so immediately it should be exhausted out. Otherwise what will happen? The persons who are working in microbiology, they know very well there is a strong smell after the decontamination. So we should put people at the ease. They should not be too much uncomfortable. So in the this I have already mentioned, the air is usually introduced into the laboratory near the entry of the desk. And it should be like where there is a more hazard, only in the, from that area it should be going out. This is one example of putting the ducts into the laboratory. There are two type of areas. One is service area, the other one is in the analytical area. The duct could be like that on the sides and in the center. We can put the duct on the all the four sides. But when we are in the analytical areas, so the preferable configuration is it should come like that in the center, and then from here also lengthwise also it should be in the center, and the breadthwise also it should be in the center. Now coming to the cables, as this picture depicts, there should not be messing up of the cables. Okay, because it can pose a risk also, and at the same time when we have to, like in case of maintenance of any equipment, then it will be very difficult to identify which cable belongs to which equipment. And all these, in this case, the service pipes from ceiling, it should be well attached to the furniture. And the cables, they should be safely organized. You make a loop, the extra wire, you just make a loop so that there should not be messing up of the cables. And all whatever void is there, that should be properly sealed. The other good example is if there are too many cables coming in, then we can use this type of the cable trays. These are the vertically oriented, and many cables, they can come through these cable trays. And this type of the example, it is of the electrical small switches which we have to provide to our appliances. And whenever these type of cable trays they are used, there should be minimum a 10 centimeter distance so that we can do the cleaning of these cables also, and we can do the cleaning behind these cable trays also. This is again example. So these are the nicely tight cables. And the other thing which we have to take care is, and even this example is that the cables, they are running through these areas from one to the other. So it's coming through here. And the other most important thing is the cable should not be very close to your source of water. Otherwise the risk of electric shock cannot be ruled out. The other thing which we put into the lab is our equipments. So when we are placing the equipments into our laboratory, so we should take into consideration that there must be located to facilitate directional workflow from low to high risk activities. For example, in this moisture room, all the ovens, they should be placed along the wall. And if it is a microbiology laboratory, then we have a biosafety cabinet also in the laboratory. We have this laminar airflow. So if we place this laminar airflow very much near to our door, entrance door, then there will be lot of fluctuations there. And if I put one this laminar airflow here and one here, again they will interpret, they will interfere the working of both. So that is why it is always better to put equipments side by side. It's mentioned here that it is, for the cost reasons also, it is advisable to locate laminar airflow cabinet together or adjacent to same wall if possible. And when we have lot of equipments in the lab, then there is again lot of noise in the lab. And it should, if we are continuously exposed to lot of noise, then definitely our hearing capacity, it starts decreasing and it starts impacting us. So it's preferable that the high noise generation equipments like pumps, if possible, it should be installed outside of the laboratory. And if we cannot, we don't have that facility to install it outside, then they must be put in a noise enclosure cabinets. These are easily available now, and so that noise is enclosed into that area only. And at the same time, the online data treatment, it means, this line means that the person who is doing data interpretation on any HPLC or the other things, or he is looking at the chromatograms to interpret the peak, then that person, he should, like, there should be some area, separate area from the analytical area, so that he is not exposed to the noise of those equipments. There should be a separation or insulation of the instrument lab. For example, we can put a glass sliding door or other screens also, so that we can reduce the noise. And whenever there is a lot of noise in the lab, then we must wear the earplugs to protect ourselves. Apart from the other equipments which we are using in the laboratory, the other presence of the other safety equipment is very, very important. There must be a portable carbon dioxide cylinder. Fire extinguisher must be there in the laboratory. There should be a safety shower equipped with, this is a eye washer. These are easily available. There must be the signals on the laboratory. If it's a microbiology laboratory, there must be a biohazard sign. There should be blanket available in the laboratory. There should be the first aid box, a cabinet. This cabinet can contain your personal protective equipments like gloves, masks, and also we can put our chemicals, bottles of our solvent acids, we can put it here. Then the signals must be there. Signals of these emergency escape routes, and these should be well lit. Like, it is not like that in the evening, like these days, we have very less light at around 6 p.m. and still people, they are working and suddenly the power goes off. So then these should be self-illuminated ones, so that it's very easy for a person to recognize where is my escape route. And if possible, in certain labs or in certain, if it's a factory laboratory, then there is some first aid room. It's available. It's not mandatory, depending upon your requirement. Then coming to the storage, when we are working with all these high tech equipments, then definitely we are using many type of gases we are using. And in that case, these acetylene, hydrogen, nitrogen oxide, or these cylinders we are using. So these are all flammable gases, and they must be located, these cylinders. They must be, first of all, they should be put it in a cage. These should be located outside of the laboratory, not inside of the laboratory. Otherwise, we will be putting ourselves at a very high risk. and it should be located out of the pedestrian and vehicle traffic. It should be under shade, no direct sunlight. Otherwise, there is a possibility if the gas is flammable, it could be source of ignition also. It should be secured from tilting. There we have heard of many cases where the person, the analyst, could not, when he was about to put the cylinder there, and suddenly the cylinder tilted and the person has a fracture on his toes. We have heard of many instances. So it should be ventilated either naturally or artificially, and it should be labeled with the warning signs. This is a highly flammable, so nobody should even, there is a possibility some person can smoke, can go and he can stand here and can do smoking. So if the sign is flammable, definitely he will not come here. And this should be equipped with the fire safety equipment. Fire safety equipment means if it's a cage or some fire extinguisher should be readily available near to this area. Last but not the least, we have the wastewater treatment also. We should not contaminate our outer environment. So while designing the laboratory, all the washing areas, all these pipes and cables, they must be go into a neutralization tank, which is fitted with a solvent separation chamber, and it should be directed to the wastewater. Only then it should be directed to the wastewater treatment plant. And all these pipes, they should be of polypropylene or PE. These should be with fire breaking sleeves in floors and through partitions. There should never be a PVC pipes must not be used, because they can be, these PVC pipes can be affected by the solvents which we are using into the laboratory. And that's all from my side. Any question? Any questions? Or if anything you think that I have not covered in the laboratory design, and you have any question particular to that thing? Sorry?
Pest control.
Pest control. Yes, you can do the pest control in the laboratory. It depends. It's more important in the microbiology laboratory. So there should not be any insects and rodents. But sometimes you cannot do pest control in your pesticide laboratories. That is not recommended at all. Earlier, this practice was being used. You can use this also, but it's better to use all these systems which I told you, the air handling units, and if the air is coming inside the through HEPA filter, and you are doing, because this whole workshop is about the good laboratory practices. Fumigation is only required when we have contaminated our whole area due to some any bad laboratory practices. If you are working in biosafety cabinets, you are handling your cultures in the biosafety cabinets, and you have all the spillage control procedures available, you have all the spill kits, and immediately contamination is removed. So definitely there will not be any need of a fumigation in the laboratory.
Ma'am, any recommended fumigation process?
Recommended, actually I'm not aware of that one, because nowadays these fumigation processes, they are not that much used. If anybody, if she can help in that question, any fumigation process recommended in the laboratory microbiology?
I think there are some recommendations in our HSC publications. Seal
Because this type of systems, when you contact to these service, these suppliers of AHU, first they will understand your requirements. And basis our requirement, then they design those systems.